Hey, Noelle Pickering here from Maneuvering the Middle, and I'm going to be teaching today on tools for remote math instruction. So this will include everything from some websites that you might want to utilize with your kids to how you can create a video lesson using materials that you might already have in a different format. So let's go ahead and get started. And I'm actually using Loom, one of the tools that I am going to discuss. But for the purpose of the rest of the presentation, I'm going to go ahead and get rid of my little face down here. Okay, so this is something that we have created here with Maneuvering the Middle, and we created these remote math lessons for grades 6 through 8. And I have gotten so many questions about how we did it and how you as teachers could do that in, for your remote instruction as well. So that's kind of what inspired this presentation. So as you can see on the screen, we have annotated over some slides and different images, and there's also voice recording. So that's one of the things I'm going to cover in here. But before we get started, I wanted to also just point that out to those of you who are listening. There are a few things you might want to consider, and there's a lot of conversations happening in different Facebook groups discussing all the different apps and websites and different tools. And I think that while it's so exciting to hear all the different things and what is working in other people's classroom, it's really easy to get overwhelmed and kind of feel like you should be doing all of these different things. So here are some things that I would recommend you consider before you commit to something. So one thing to consider is, will your students need another account and or a login? Depending on what you already have set up, sometimes using a new feature or a new website requires a student login. And if you haven't been using that all year long, that might be just another hindrance for students actually participating. So really consider if they need another account or login and how you could facilitate that, or is there something that you could do differently that wouldn't require that? So that's one thing to keep in mind. The other thing to keep in mind is, how often are your students hearing your voice and seeing your face? So I love Loom, and I'll talk about it in a minute, but because they can, you can communicate with your voice and your face. You can even have a little bubble down in the bottom the whole time. Or there are other live calls, depending on what your district requirements are. But what I would just remind you is that they're used to seeing you and used to hearing things taught in your voice and in your mannerisms. So if possible, even if you're using pre-recorded things from the internet, YouTube, Khan Academy, any of those math tools, that you're also, even if it's just a quick like checking in using a video recording system of some sort. And then the last one is, have you communicated your expectations clearly? And this all started as a conversation in a Facebook group for a teacher that actually started really early with her remote instruction. And she said that she did a lot of things accidentally correct. And that's why she thought she was having such high participation. And one of the things she said is, she spent the very first day making them a video showing them exactly how things would work, just like I'm doing right here, or just like you might do for your students. So just really thinking about, have you communicated those expectations clearly? And really, video is gonna be the best way to do that. If you, especially if you're introducing a new tool or a new website that you want students to use, that's something to consider. So these are just things to ponder before moving forward in any of the tools that I'm gonna present today. And I'll try really clearly to articulate if it requires a login or if it's just something for you as the teacher. The last thing I wanted to share is that we created a free remote math lessons for grades 6 through 8. That's kind of who we're focused on, supporting teachers and serving them. So if you're interested in those and that applies to you, you can go to the website on the screen, and that's one way that you can check them out. At the end of the presentation today, I'm gonna have a website for all of the different tools that I discussed, and you'll be able to grab that bit.ly link at the end. Okay, so I've kind of broken this down by the different objective that the tool will help you with. And that's another thing that I find really overwhelming, is when people ask for a question, lots of people are sharing different websites, but they don't always explain what that website can be used for. So I'm trying to organize this for you. So if you are looking to record your screen, whether that be like what I'm doing, where you're have a presentation of some sort and you're recording your voice or your face to go along with it. If it means you want to record your screen in such a way that you are recording yourself discussing something or teaching something and then sending it, these are different options that work really well for you. I'm using Loom and I love Loom. It is free for teachers. It has no time limit. You can record both the screen or your face, and then you can download a link. It very quickly populates a link for you, or you can download it so you can store it yourself. And if you even want to include a password, you can do that. So that way students have to use the password. It also tells you the very first time it's viewed. So that's kind of nice. Another favorite that I investigated because so many people recommend it is the website called Edpuzzle. So Loom would probably be something that you are creating and you are teaching. Edpuzzle is different because it's where you're actually pulling content that is already created. You can also do it, but you would have to create that slideshow in advance or a video in advance. This is something because you can import lessons from Khan Academy, YouTube. There's even some science features in there. So it allows you to bring in that lesson or that video, and then you actually pause, you can pause the video and require students to answer a question before the video progresses. It's also really nice because it'll tell you who watched the whole video. You can have different settings that they can't move forward until they answer the question, things like that. It has a lot of really neat features. The learning curve was not too steep, I don't think. I was able to pick up on it rather quickly. The thing here is that students will need an account. So you can have a free basic account. I believe it's about between $8 and $11 for a larger account, which allows you to create more videos and keep more information. But your students will have to have an account. So that would be something that you would have to set up with them. Whereas Loom, if you're just sharing information, that's you creating an account and sending them a link. You know, they don't have to log in. And then the last one I shared, I don't have a ton of use with it, and I really prefer Loom, but a lot of people like Screencastify. I think they like it because it's a Chrome extension, so it's really easy to just include in your Google Chrome, and it also auto saves your recordings to Google Drive. Again, it's a shorter time limit. They only allow 5 minutes, or for $30 per year for teachers, you can get extended time. So that's something to consider. Let me show you what some of these websites look like. So this is an example of loom.com. This is the homepage you'll see. And then over on the right here are the different options. So you can do your screen with the camera. You can just do your screen, or you can just do your camera. You can check if you have a Mac. This will show up on your top desk or top bar next to the time and the Wi-Fi. And then you can just click start recording. It's super easy. And then at the end of the video, you can even add like a link at the end that you want students to click. There is a limit. I think it's 100, but they've been really a little bit unclear. Right now they're supporting teachers for 100% free as long as you want, as long as the videos are. And I can only say great things about them. Edpuzzle looks a little bit like this. So here is one of our remote lessons where we pulled that in, or actually teacher pulled this video from YouTube into her Edpuzzle. And once there, over here on the right, you can see that there was an open-ended question. So she wants students to answer that, and they have to either submit it, they can skip, or they can rewatch. So it kind of creates checkpoints along the way. Okay, so now let's look at annotating and screen recording. There are two other websites that came highly recommended that I checked out. One is called EduCreations. It is only available on an iPad, so that's something to keep in mind. It has a free basic account or $11.99 for a pro account. It allows you to pull in images or documents and then annotate or voice over them on the pro. That's really nice. I'm going to show you some other things that will work on an iPad, but this is one that came recommended. And then you can share the link, or you can download it and store it yourself. And then if you're looking for something, there's another one called Dossery. They have an iPad that's free in the App Store, and then they have a $30 one for a desktop, and it basically allows you to do the same thing. The nice thing about this is when you get back to your classroom, if you have an iPad, they allow remote desktop control, which is really cool, and it might be something that you would enjoy using. Okay, now if you want to annotate PDFs, Google Slides, or PowerPoint, and you're not interested in using a combo, so on the slide before, this is going to annotate and record at the same time. These are things that I recommend if you are going to annotate on and use a recorder. So for example, you could annotate with good notes on an iPad, and then you could just record at the same time using Loom. That's what I like to do, but again, there are lots of other options. GoodNotes is an app on the iPad, and it's a $7.99 one-time fee. You can connect your Google Drive or your Dropbox, and you just bring in the document. So once you connect them, it's really nice. They're all there. You choose the document, and then you can annotate over it. You can highlight. You can add little images or drawings. It's really nice for some sort of presentation, especially if you're explaining something to a student. And then Lumen PDF is free for 14 days or $5 for the month. And it allows you to annotate by integrating Google Drive. Now, I will say annotating like with handwriting is going to be so much easier on a tablet versus on a desktop. So I'm going to show you some options there in just a minute. Okay, so here are tools for annotating. So if you have an iPad already, it may be compatible with an Apple Pencil, and it'll definitely be compatible with a stylus that you can grab off of Amazon. And so that would be what I would most, I think you'd have the most success with, because it allows you to use apps from the App Store, and you can use it in different functions. But if you don't, and you're working on a desktop or a laptop, you might be interested in a Wacom board or an X-Pen board and their annotation. So it kind of works like a special piece of paper or special, like almost like feels like a clipboard. And it comes with the writing utensil, and you'll be able to annotate using that writing utensil. So they either plug in or sync to your computer. And so that way you have that ability to write and actually write with your handwriting instead of trying to write with a mouse. And these are quite a bit more affordable than the iPad and the Apple Pencil. They both range in the $60 range, whereas an iPad and an Apple Pencil is going to be several hundred dollars. So that's another more affordable way that totally works and would make it a little bit easier to annotate. Okay, so let's say you want to add some interactive tools to your toolbox or your virtual classroom. Here are some that I would recommend. So we have Quizzes, Quizlet, and Gimkit. And they all are similar but a little bit different. So depending on if your students are familiar with any of these platforms, I would definitely start with the one they are most familiar with, if possible. And then I would also start with ones that you feel most confident in. So all of them are going to be some form of a review game type show game, things like that. So Quizzes is going to be a student-paced one. And in that, you can actually create your own. So you can create matching, vocabulary. It's kind of like a flashcard system that they can that they create a game out of. It's also similar to some of these other ones, but the main difference here is that it is a student-paced one and that students will play individually. In Quizlet, it's a collaborative one. So this is going to require a little bit more tech on your side. You're going to have some form of way for grouping the students. If you've been using this in your classroom already, then I definitely suggest it. If you have not done it, it might be something that you consider for later when everyone's really up and going with this remote instruction, or that you test out with like maybe one class of students before you plan for everyone to do that. You can use Zoom to create breakout rooms to play Quizlet live in a live setting, and I've heard great things about that. But again, it takes a little bit more work up front because it's a collaborative thing, so students will have to be grouped together. The students will have to be on the software at the same time, things like that. And then Gimkit is another great game show review, and it has its kind of twist to it is that it has power-ups, so there are free and paid versions, and you can use, again, create or use already created quizzes. The students do play individually here. There's a little bit more competition in the sense that students can earn power-ups, and then they can play those to make their questions worth more points. So there's a little bit more of an incentive there or strategy, I should say. But again, I would just recommend starting with whatever you feel most comfortable with, whatever your students feel most comfortable with. And if you haven't done any of these, then maybe that's something you kind of get your feet wet with remote instruction before introducing these. But these are all great options for games. Okay, I wanted to share a few more math-specific websites. If you haven't tried Desmos, this is a really great activity. Everything on there is free. They are all student-paced. Now, they are designed to be used in a classroom environment, so there will be times within the student or the teacher guide or even the student guide where it'll like tell students to discuss or it'll point out things that you as the teacher can discuss. So obviously those would be a little bit more difficult to integrate as far as facilitating that. However, all the activities students can do on their own. They are activities and explorations around a math concept. So whereas the slide before where I talked about games, that would be something that you have already taught that you're using as a review or that you're practicing. The activities in Desmos are a lot of times intended to be used as an exploration or an introduction or an extension to a different concept. And I will say they are mostly focused on grades 6 through 12. So that's something to consider when you're looking. And students work individually in this setting. And then if you're younger, there is a website called Dreambox. It's normally something that's a little bit on the pricier side and something that districts subscribe to. And I believe they had a parent account beforehand, but now because of COVID-19, they've really opened it up for a free 90-day trial for teachers and parents. So this might be something that you, if this is a new thing, that's one more login and one more thing that students are going to have to keep track of and parents as well. But it may be something that if a parent is asking for additional support, you could point them to this free trial for 90 days. It's more focused on grades 6 through 5. I believe it goes older, but and these are, again, more student-paced practice type activities in a gamified format. And I wanted to share all of the links here. There, I have a blog post, and you can find it at this bit.ly link here, bit.ly/remote-math-tools. Make sure to capitalize the letters correctly. But there's more links on that page than I included in the presentation, but I did want the presentation to be something that was helpful and more succinct. The website, the blog post has many more links and ideas, but I wanted to share what I figured were the best ones to get started with to address the specific needs you might have in your classroom. So I appreciate being here with you, and I hope that this was something that you found helpful and can take back with you in your new e-learning environment. So best of luck, and I'm happy to answer any questions if you have any. Thanks so much.